Howdy, Crumb Bums. It's time for another episode of Canonically Crumb, the only show that examines the comics and characters of the Crummyverse. Anthropomorphic animal characters were nothing new to comics in the late 1940s and early 1950s. They had been in newspaper comics since the 19th century, and many great artists have taken a crack at the genre over the years. Harvey Kurtzman, Frank Frazetta, Jack Kirby, with the undisputed king of funny animal artists being Uncle Scrooge creator Carl Barks. The young Crumb brothers, Bob and Chuck, were huge fans of the genre at the time, and we can find many references to their favorite funny animal characters in Robert's work. Donald Duck, Felix the Cat, Heckle and Jekyll, Super Rabbit, Mighty Mouse, Gandy Goose and Sourpuss, Uncle Dunkle, and my personal favorite, Super Duck, who Crumb would pay homage to 5 decades later in Mystic Funnies number 3. In fact, funny animal characters have always been a staple of the Crumb oeuvre, from Fritz the Cat to Dirty Dog, Patricia Pig, God, and of course the characters we're looking at today, those cute little bearsy-wearsies. Aww. As always, we need to acknowledge that, for our purposes, Robert Crumb's canon includes The Big Yum Yum Book, The Complete Crumb, The Weirdo Years, Zap, Hup, Mystic Funnies, and A Bit of Dirty Laundry. Now we find these little bears all over the Crumb canon. Sometimes they play a minor role, but most often they appear as chicken fat in the background. It's unclear if any or all of these appearances are the same characters recurring over and over again, or if they're just background characters added for texture. We do, however, have 5 canonical appearances of these cuddly critters in which they're clearly identified. The first was drawn in June of 1967 and published in 68 in Yellow Dog No. 5, a comic magazine from the Print Mint, which was published as weekly as possible. Simply titled, Those Cute Little Bearsy-Wearsies, our first unnamed bear begins by asking the other one, "Listen, are you happy with your present existence?" The bears go on to discuss their feelings for one another and why they're afraid or unwilling to take their relationship to the next level. At the end, the blonde bear goes to the bathroom, leaving the first bear alone and wanting a cigarette. The conceit of this first strip seems to be that the bearsy-wearsies subvert our expectations of superficial cuteness in a funny animal comic in favor of existential dread and crippling ennui. Their second, much more zany appearance is drawn about a year later in 1968 and was first published in the East Village Other. Here the bears are depicted in more of the rubber hose animation style that was popular in cartoons of the 1930s. A key factor in the change seems to be that the first strip was created pre-Zap, whereas the second comes after the Pandora's box of underground comics has already been opened. The tone of the first strip is far more in line with Crumb's early Fritz comics, or even his childhood comics with his brother Charles. However, by 1968, we're well into the era of happy hippie comics. Not at all simply titled, Freak Out Funnies presents Those Cute Little Bearsy-Wearsies, subtitle, Comics for Flipped Out Flower Kids. It's a bit of a mouthful. We find the two delinquent bears looking to score some easy cash. We see an old woman waiting for the bus, revealing that the bearsy-wearsies, unlike Fritz, live in a world of both anthropomorphic animals as well as humans. They gruesomely murder her and take her purse, then proceed to assault a sailor with a bottle and take his wallet. A cop chases them, but they evade his pursuit with some strategically spilt oil. We're now introduced to our first bear with a name, Boopsy, who here resembles Minnie Mouse from the 1940s. The darker bear flirts with Boopsy and brags about being flush with cash. This angers the blonde bear, who turns on his friend. The first bear avoids getting bashed by a board with a nail in it, using his concealed pistol. However, Boopsy has an idea to end the hostilities. A menage a trois. This gives the blonde bear an idea, and they pimp out Boopsy and live happily ever after. This is the most cartoony of the bearsy-wearsy strips, and consequently my favorite. There's so many off-the-wall twists and turns, and a total lack of any kind of morality or even consequence. It's just good fun, you know? Incidentally, we'll see that this is the most out-of-character entry into the Bearsies series, and ultimately doesn't really fit the tone or style of the rest of the comics. So nearly 8 years pass before we get any more Bearsy Wearsy's appearances outside of the sporadic background appearances. Then, dated 1976 and first published in Arcade, the Comics Review number 6, we find the little Bearsy Wearsy's in Ain't It Nice. No longer a comic about two fuzzy dudes, it begins with the narration, Jippo and Boopsy are in love. Perhaps something sinister has happened to the other bear. We'll never know. Jippo and Boopsy are walking down the street. They're physically violent with each other, but it's played off as their quirky sexual relationship dynamic. Jippo spots a shoe store and gives Boopsy some money to go buy a new pair of shoes. He grows impatient, waiting 45 minutes for Boopsy to make her purchase. Boopsy points out that in her new shoes, she's now taller than Jippo, and Jippo childishly tries to assert his dominance in the relationship. They then go to the park to fool around, but are interrupted by peeping youngsters. Heading home to Screw, Jippo suggests they first pick up a bottle of wine. Boopsy is concerned that alcohol will impede his ability to sustain an erection, but Jippo promises he simply likes how wild and horny Boopsy gets when she drinks. Outside the liquor store, Boopsy complains about the price of Jippo's selection and reminds him that he needs to get the car fixed and has also been talking about quitting his job. This talk of work sends Jippo into a rage, but luckily a cop comes along and shoos them home before it can escalate into serious domestic violence. Back at the crib, we find out Jippo has a wife who he's separated from and children. Boopsy really doesn't like Jippo's wife, but Jippo suggests that they should go over there sometime next week to visit. So it's a somewhat amicable situation. The pair dance to music and drink heavily, especially Boopsy. She becomes extremely drunk and destructive. Boopsy breaks a record and Jippo becomes very aggressive with her, and this leads to the pair having violent sex. Later, Boopsy talks about how much she enjoyed it and assures Jippo that he shouldn't feel guilty because she likes it rough. Over coffee, Boopsy expresses her love for Jippo. He's not sentimental, but agrees to call her from work the next day if he can find the time. The comic ends with the pair in bed kissing. Very sweet. This comic does some interesting work juxtaposing domestic violence and intimacy, anger and lust, and it challenges the parameters of a healthy relationship, although I'm unsure anyone would consider Jippo and Boopsy's relationship to be particularly healthy. It also does a good job of establishing the characters. Jippo has anger and inadequacy issues, which he masks with a self-assured facade. He's also impulsive and has a complicated relationship with his sadosexual fantasies. Boopsy comes across as confident, but less self-serious than Jippo, and totally comfortable with her sexuality. She's the more responsible of the pair, although she lacks impulse control when drinking. She also has a greater capacity to love, even with Jippo, who can't express it verbally. 2 years later, in 1978, we get a single strip in Coevolution Quarterly, an offshoot of the Whole Earth catalog. This one's called Those Cute Little Bears We Love So Much. In it, the bears are back to their existential roots, as Boopsy and Jippo share a bath and discuss whether a moral imperative exists in the context of inevitable death. The final message is, life is an art. Jippo and Boopsy's relationship in these last two Bearsy comics draws a lot of parallels with Robert and his real-life partner, Eileen. They had lived together in a sort of commune situation on the same property as Crumb's then-wife Dana, and they collaborated on comics about their relationship. According to their comics, their dynamic was quite similar to the Bearsy Wearsies, including bathing together and all the wrestling and big-ass escapades. They were married sometime around when this comic was made, either soon before or soon after. Our final comic for the day also appeared in the Coevolution Quarterly about a year later in 1979, titled, And Now Those Cute, Adorable Little Bearsy Wearsies. The bears have come full circle, sitting once again in nature and pondering the big questions. This leads to bickering and Jippo releasing some pent-up male aggression on Boopsy's posterior. They go for a quick skinny dip, after which Boopsy says she's hungry. Jippo climbs a tree to fetch some eggs from a nest, but can't figure out how to get down while holding them. Boopsy climbs a tree to see what's taking so long, only to find out that Jippo has selfishly eaten both eggs. Then, Mama Bird returns, forcing the Bearsy Wearsies out of the tree. Soaked, Boopsy bops Jippo in the face, saying, You're not one bit cute! To which he replies, All in all, it's been a great life. In the bottom corner, we get narration, the end. Question mark? And that's it. No more cute little bearsy-wearsies. So why not? There's an overall decline in the number of funny animal comics in the canon around this time, as we enter the weirdo years. Crumb's work becomes more directly autobiographical, and so he may have had little use for cute little bears as allegory for his relationship. Their daughter Sophie was born shortly after the final Bearsy-Wearsy comic, and it's likely their relationship underwent a significant paradigm shift. Crumb continued to draw the same ass-punching, face-pressing, sexual perversions in his comics, but not with the bears. It's possible returning to old fantasies seemed less trodden with fresh characters. Perhaps those cute little Bearsy-Wearsies just ran out of steam. Share your thoughts in the comments. Well, Crumb Bums, this marks the end of another episode of Canonically Crumb. If you've enjoyed this show, make sure to hit like, hit subscribe, be a ding-dong daddy, and ding that bell. I've been your host, Kyle Bridget. You can find my links in the show description, and join me in the Nostril Zone, where we listen to tunes and draw cartoons every Sunday from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Central Time. And if you want to support this program and myself, you'll also find my Patreon links in the show description as well. Canonically Crumb will be back as weekly as possible with another deep dive into the Crummyverse. Thanks again, Crumb Bums, and keep on junkin'.